Good afternoon and welcome to this press conference from the 48th annual meeting of the World Economic Forum in Davos. Thank you for joining us here in the room. Thank you for joining those who watch us on Periscope, on the website, or on Facebook. We're particularly pleased and honored today here to have the ability to introduce to you the Prime Minister of Poland, Mateusz Morawiecki, and to his immediate left, we're joined by Konrad Szymański, who's the Deputy Foreign Minister of Poland. Without further ado, Prime Minister, over to you, please.
Thank you very much, and I would also like to thank everybody who is watching us and interested in the perspective of Poland and how we look at the World Economic Forum. And its motto here, committed to improving the state of the world, is also the motto for Poland. Maybe we focus more on the European dimension, but we take it very seriously. And in this very context, we focus also on completing the single European market, and this is what I was discussing with many of my colleagues from Western and Eastern Europe. It might seem strange, but I truly believe that we can increase the competitiveness of the whole Europe, and through this we can contribute a lot to more positive world if we complete the single European market through real implementation of freedom to provide services. This is one of the four freedoms of the Treaty of Rome, not yet completed, and this is one area where we try to find allies. Of course, in the world post-Brexit, it is going to be a little bit more difficult, but the countries like Norway, in the context of European Economic Zone area, but in Denmark and the Netherlands and other countries are going to support us in those efforts. Well, like the European Union for us is like two lungs, the Western Europe and Eastern Europe, and like in the post-war Europe, the Marshall Plan was in the interest of Europe, but in the interest of the US at the same time, because it has recreated Western Europe and helped it flourish and develop in the very right direction. And then Western Europe became a very critical ally for the United States. In the very similar manner today, I believe that some support and opening of markets and lowering trade barriers and softening some protectionist measures would help to develop the robust Central and Eastern Europe, which will then in turn be a very good element supporting the development of competitiveness and the development of the European Union as such. We have also discussed lots of security related issues, not only energy security like related to the Baltic Pipe or Nord Stream 2, but also the security in general, the Russian invasion on Ukraine, the Minsk agreement, and many other security-related issues also in the context of the refugees, migrations. This is the area where we would like to play a positive role, and we present our very active position towards helping the poor people, those very poor people, migrants and refugees in situ, in the places where they are coming from to Europe. And also, like the responsibility of the elites, some people call this meeting in Davos the meeting of elites, is also tackling imbalances and inequalities in today's world. And the report of Oxfam presented just before the World Economic Forum started, which is showing the proportions of the wealth created and where does it go? 82% of the newly created wealth goes to the pockets of 1% of the population in the world. And the question hanging in the air here, is this sustainable? Is it not? In my opinion, it is not. So we have to work on a new deal, on new social contract, like in Europe and in some other places in the world. In the post-war era, there was a new social contract established, and today, with the new circumstances, new challenges around us in the context of the era of robotics, artificial intelligence, rapid technological changes, we need new proposition for millions, if not hundreds of millions, yes, hundreds of millions of people all over the world, but also there is significant part of the population across different countries in the European Union who are extremely anxious, uneasy about the changes around us. And our economic growth has to be strong, but has to be inclusive at the same time. That's maybe as an opening remarks. For Polish journalists, should I repeat it more or less in Polish, or is it okay that I stop now and?
Well, yes, it would be nice if you say something in Polish.
It would be nice, okay. Szanowni Państwo, krótko streszczę to, co powiedziałem w Czarodziejskiej Górze Tomasza Manna 100 lat temu. W tym miejscu elity ówczesnego świata zastanawiały się nad wyzwaniami, jakie są przed nimi. Rozpoznały te wyzwania dość słabo, bo wiemy, jak się potem potoczyło kilkadziesiąt kolejnych lat. Później, po II wojnie światowej, w ramach planu Marszała dla Europejskiej Wspólnoty Węgla i Stali, ówczesne elity rozpoznały wyzwania słusznie. I dzisiaj, myślę, po kolejnych kilkudziesięciu latach jesteśmy właśnie na takim znowu zakręcie historii, w ramach którego musimy głęboko przemyśleć wyzwania współczesnego świata związane z nierównościami. To ten słynny raport Oxfarmu, który mówi tu dzisiejszym elitom, że nie może być dalej tak, że 82% tworzonego majątku, tworzonej wartości dodanej idzie w ręce 1% najbogatszych ludzi, a połowa biedniejsza połowa ludzkości, przypomnę, jest to 3 700 000 000 ludzi, właściwie nie ma w ogóle przyrostu majątku. Więc w takich okolicznościach dyskusja nad lepszym światem, nad regulacjami, nad zasadami inkluzywnego wzrostu jest moim zdaniem fundamentalna. I Polska oraz Europa Centralna ma szansę pozytywnie przyczynić się do rozwoju, sytuacji ekonomicznej, finansowej, właśnie akcentując to, że ten przypływ musi rzeczywiście podnosić wszystkie łódki, a nie niektórych zostawiać na plaży, bo rozwój gospodarczy, który nie włącza społeczeństwa, który nie służy tym zwyczajnym ludziom, który omija ich, nie będzie zaakceptowany w ramach demokracji, w ramach różnych krajach, więc warto przyłożyć ogromną uwagę właśnie do tego, żeby dzisiaj rozpoznać wyzwania przyszłości i tak je adresować, żeby ogromna większość ludzi korzystała na wzroście gospodarczym i na stabilności politycznej, którą dzisiaj mamy. Dziękuję.
Thank you very much, Prime Minister. We have a few minutes for questions. You might ask the question either in English or Polish, as you wish. We have a microphone here. If I could see a show of hands. There's a gentleman in the back. Let's take the first two questions there, please.
Marcin Czapski, TVP Info. Panie premierze, chciałem zapytać, czy jakieś sukcesy możemy już odnotować? Wczoraj słyszeliśmy o tej deklaracji ze strony Google. Czy po kolejnych rozmowach coś jeszcze padło?
Ja podkreślam, że tutaj głównie rozmawia się, przedstawia rację danego kraju, promuje Polskę, w tym w przypadku moim, pana prezydenta i moim. I to jest podstawowa funkcja, podstawowy cel naszej wizyty. Ale oprócz tego oczywiście rzeczywiście z wieloma liderami różnych organizacji, Philips, Google, Mittal, ArcelorMittal, rozmawiałem o zwiększeniu ich obecności w Polsce i ogromna większość tych rozmów jest bardzo pozytywna, ale główny cel mojej wizyty tutaj to właśnie szukanie sojuszników w wyzwaniach współczesnego świata i Europy, takich jak bezpieczeństwo na styku Rosja-Ukraina, Europa Centralna, Nord Stream 2 i dalsza monopolizacja dostaw gazu do Europy, nasz gazociąg bałtycki, o którym rozmawiałem dzisiaj rano z panią premier Norwegii, z panem premierem Danii, ale również z premierem Holandii. To są fundamentalnie ważne tematy dla bezpieczeństwa europejskiego, dla bezpieczeństwa energetycznego, dla solidarności energetycznej i dla budowania takiego porządku gospodarczego, który nie będzie opierał się o zwiększanie ryzyk i politykę beggar thy neighbor, czyli takiej w ciężar kosztów kogoś innego, tylko będzie rzeczywiście oparty o zasady solidarności.
Thank you very much. And let's get the second question from the gentleman back there, please.
Yes, Prime Minister, I'm not sure. I can't understand everything you said in Polish, so maybe it could double a bit. So you mentioned two things. I have two questions. The first thing is you talked about the New Deal. Can you give us some more concrete measures, what it is about, how should it look? And the second thing is you want to deepen the common market. Also, some more details, please. That would be nice. Thank you very
much. Could you also share your name and organization
with
us, please?
Yes, my name is Sven Astama by FAZ, German Daily.
Thank you. In the context of the first question, what I really mean is that today, with the rapid technological changes, so many people are fearful of their jobs, of their working place, that we have to create a vision presented to them that they will not be left alone. That the new social contract will have some proposition for them, even if they are unemployed, or what the unemployment state is going to be, what will it really mean for those people. According to lots of recent researchers by renowned universities, some 50 to 60% of today's jobs will get lost over the next 15 to 20 years, and probably new type of jobs, new occupations are going to be created. I have no doubts about this, but for many people, most of children, as they say, which are in the process of education today, they will not be employed in sectors which are existing today. So huge, vast changes which have to be addressed through new social contract. I would name it like this. Your second question was about the single European market, common market, and maybe a couple of simple examples. One is freedom to provide services, which the biggest attempts to really deliver on this, the famous Bolkestein directive, failed some decade ago. And today we see some protectionist measures on the side of some richer countries. And those measures are going to jeopardize the competitiveness of the whole European Union. And in my opinion, it's better to allow for more competition from small and mid-size Central and Eastern European companies, allow for this competition, because this is a kind of proxy for the competition which will anyway come from the other regions in the world, like China, like India, like the United States, or Latin America, or the Middle East. And in this context, completing the single European market from the point of view of freedom to provide services is going to be good short and mid-term for for Central and Eastern Europe, but it's going to be very good for the whole European Union in the mid to longer term. I would also mention Capital Markets Union, because this is another element of the whole jigsaw, which is by far not completed. And this is this type of access to capital, which is extremely important for small and mid-sized enterprises. So I would emphasize those elements. And on top of this, a couple of others, like I only mention those, like common defense policy, like the European Defense Fund, we strongly support it, permanent structured cooperation, and the works around the directive on posted workers. These are these elements where we have to find compromise for the single European market to be stronger rather than weaker.
Thank you very much. I think we have time for one last question from the lady in the middle here, please.
Patrycja Maciejewicz, Polish Daily Gazeta Wyborcza. I would like to ask you, Mr. Prime Minister, to refer to few specific questions. First of all, here in Davos, we were said a lot of words of concern about that there is too much of complacency and the government should build some buffers on the time of economic downturn. Do you agree with them? What particular risks do you have you already defined? The second question is, could you refer to the statement of a Supreme Court spokesperson in Poland that you are spreading fake news or generalize talking about judiciary system in Poland? And maybe some more evaluation about cryptocurrency threats and your measures which you would like to implement. Thank you.
Considering the advanced time, I'd say we probably focus on the questions that concern the international agenda and maybe keep the domestic questions for a later point. But Prime Minister.
Well, it is very important item discussed here in Davos, how to actually cope for the risks from of the future and how to build buffers, and what if the monetary policy is no longer effective in the context of dealing with today's difficulties. And this was the topic of many discussions which I led yesterday and today. And in this very context, I have emphasized what we have done in the area of tax gathering system, tax collection system. Here we have been extremely successful in 2017 because we were able to close more than half of the VAT gap, which has created a completely new economic situation where we have expanded our social programs and at the same time we have reduced our projected budget deficit, and our public debt is lower in relation, much lower in relation to GDP than it was and it used to be a year ago. And on top of this, our GDP growth is today much stronger than 90% of rating agencies and brokerage houses and financial institutions would have predicted just 12 months ago. So it is indicating that our concoction of different elements in the context of micro policy and regulatory policy, so our policy mix, including independent central bank with their monetary policy, works very well. And for some other countries in the Central and Eastern Europe, we can be a good example of how to get out of some traps which we fall into after 25 years of the development, which was not bad, but it could have been much better if not the mistakes from the past. To your latter question, only one sentence. Well, it's only about facts. The facts have been published. How many judges in today's Supreme Court? I regret very much that so many judges in the Supreme Court stem from the times of the martial law, when during the very dark communist times, they were active judges supporting communist regime.
Thank you very much, Prime Minister, for taking the time to answer questions from media. Thank you very much for being here in the room. Thank you very much for watching. Thank you.
Thank you.